Verse 39. And when the centurion which stood over against him saw that he so cried out and gave up the ghost, he said, Truly, this man was the Son of God. There were also women looking on afar off, among whom was Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James the Less and of Joseph and Salome, who also, when he was in Galilee, followed him and ministered unto him, and many other women which came up with him unto Jerusalem. Note, the women were there. There's something about a woman's heart that is softer than that of most men. It seems that women are more spiritually inclined, more sensitive to the Holy Spirit. They had done so much for him, even ministering to him financially. Verse 42, And now when the even was come, because it was the preparation, that is, the day before the Sabbath, Joseph of Arimathea, an honorable counselor, which also weighed for the kingdom of God, came and went in boldly unto Pilate and craved the body of Jesus. Note, this is a tremendously significant thing that Joseph of Arimathea did. Joseph is thought to have been one of the members of the Jewish Sanhedrin, the highest supreme court of the land. He was a very highly thought of man, also rich. He had newly hewn out a tomb for his own burial. But when he came to beg Pilate to let him have the body, he saved Jesus from the mass burial. Now you think a moment, if this had not happened, and Jesus' body had been taken down with those others who were crucified, and they were buried in mass graves, what an implausible thing it would have been for people to believe he could have been raised from the dead. How would they have known which body had been raised? But even in these infinitesimally small things, God was at work, crossing the T's and dotting the I's, leaving nothing to chance. Never fret, my friend. Jesus is in control. There's always going to be somebody ready to be raised up, or to come forward, or to do a specific thing that must be done in harmony with the eternal plan of God. Verse 44. And Pilate marveled if he were already dead. And calling unto him the centurion, he asked him whether he had been any while dead. And when he knew it of the centurion, he gave the body to Joseph. Note, Pilate didn't even realize the significance of what he was doing. I'm sure he didn't know what motivated him, but God was even using the Roman ruler to fulfill prophecy. Verse 46, And he bought fine linen, and took him down, and wrapped him in the linen, and laid him in a sepulchre which was hewn out of a rock, and rolled a stone under the door of the sepulchre. And Mary Magdalene and Mary the mother of Joseph beheld where he was laid. Chapter 16. And when the Sabbath was past, Mary Magdalene and Mary the mother of James and Salome had bought sweet spices that they might come and anoint him. And very early in the morning, the first day of the week, they came unto the sepulchre at the rising of the sun. And they said among themselves, Who shall roll us away the stone from the door of the sepulchre? Note, they did not know that the Jews had come to Pilate and prevailed upon him to put the government seal upon the tomb. are upon the rock, so that if anybody would break the seal, it would mean they would be put to death. The Jews were doing everything in their power so that the Christians would not get away with saying that Jesus had been risen from the dead. Verse 4, and when they looked, they saw that the stone was rolled away, for it was very great. And entering into the sepulchre, they saw a young man sitting on the right side, clothed in a long white garment, and they were affrighted. And he saith unto them, be not affrighted, ye seek Jesus of Nazareth, which was crucified. He is risen. He is not here. Behold, the place where they laid him. But go your way. Tell his disciples and Peter that he goeth before you into Galilee. There shall ye see him as he said unto you. Note. You see, Jesus was concerned about Peter, as he is about any of us when we think we can do so much and yet in our weakness let Christ down. When we have so much promise, when we have the life that might have been, he's so concerned that we have the inner strength and the recognition of his love and mercy to be able to carry out our mission in life. Verse 8, and they went out quickly and fled from the sepulchre, for they trembled and were amazed. Neither said they anything to any man, for they were afraid. Note, the first thing about them was they were frightened. Next, they trembled. Then they were amazed. And then they didn't tell anybody. And finally, they were terribly afraid. Why does God include such details in the account of the resurrection? He told it like it was. This was no built-up thing. This was reality. And these women were reacting in a normal way. Verse 9. Now when Jesus was risen early the first day of the week, he appeared first to Mary Magdalene, out of whom he had cast seven devils. Note, this woman who had been demon-possessed was delivered so completely and had served him so devotedly that he now reveals himself to her. Verse 10, and she went and told them that had been with him, as they mourned and wept. And they, when they had heard that he was alive and had been seen of her, believed not. Note, have you ever known something of God so deeply and so realistically that you just had to tell it, and yet you couldn't get anybody to believe you? Well, that's what happened to Mary Magdalene. They didn't believe her. Verse 12, after that he appeared in another form unto two of them as they walked and went into the country. And they went and told it unto the residue, neither believed they them. Afterward he appeared unto the 11 as they set at meat, and upbraided them with their unbelief and hardness of heart, because they believed not them which had seen him after he was risen. Note, now Jesus never accepts our unbelief or hardness of heart. He had told the angel to tell them to go into Galilee, and especially tell Peter also, that he would meet them there. He cared so much about them, but he cared so much that he told them the truth about their unbelief. He upbraided them for their hardness of heart. They not only had forsook him and fled at the cross, but now they didn't believe what he had told them about his rising from the dead. Verse 15. And he said unto them, Go ye into all the world, and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned. Note, Jesus shows us that this gospel has to be in movement, in motion, in activity. It is not to become sterile and stale and stagnant. He said, Go, and go ye. An eminently personal thing. Go ye. We should go to the house of God that we might be strengthened by the gospel of Jesus Christ and taught in how to lift up the name of our Lord and reproduce his life in the world. And then we are to go. Our main work is outside the church sanctuary. It's out there among the people. Either go or you send somebody, and you know that as you send them, your heart goes with them. And also, when he said, go ye into all the world, he meant go into every man's world. That is to say, when we see which way men think and how they live, we enter into that situation with them to reproduce the life of Christ through our witness. And he said, preach. Preach the gospel. Verse 17, And these signs shall follow them that believe. In my name shall they cast out devils. They shall speak with new tongues. They shall take up serpents. And if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. Note, you know, when we can't do certain things legally, we give that power to our attorneys, so that when they speak, they're speaking for us, and we have put at their disposal all of our authority. Jesus is saying, when we believe, we'll be saved, and when we believe, then he gives us the power of his name and the power of attorney, so that in my name, Christ said, you shall cast out devils. You shall speak with new tongues. They shall take up serpents. Now, this doesn't mean snake handling. You know, if snake handling was going to bring deliverance, then we might as well get the snake handlers of Burma and India and other places. Their snake handling doesn't save souls or heal the sick or extend the gospel. This simply means, as these people went forth into the world to preach the gospel to every creature, they might be bit with a snake, and they would be immune from that snake bite. And then if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. The same would be true if enemies tried to poison them. They would be immune. And then they that believe shall lay their hands on the sick, and they shall recover. That's not merely touching somebody with your hands. It is your heart and your faith working through your hands, through the name of Christ, that causes the sick to recover. Verse 19. So then, after the Lord had spoken unto them, he was received up into heaven and sat on the right hand of God. And they went forth and preached everywhere, the Lord working with them, and confirming the word with signs following. Amen. Note, this is the way Mark ends his gospel. He began it with action. He closes it with greater action. And what is the greater action? That these disciples went forth in the name of Christ to do his mighty deeds as if Jesus had never died. Instead of one Jesus, there were thousands of little Christs. And the very things that Christ said would happen did happen He worked with them. And he confirmed, approved his word with these signs following. Devils are cast out. People spoke with new tongues. And nothing of serpents or poison destroyed them. They laid their hands on the sick and they recovered. That was the confirmation. And friend, it's the confirmation today. I praise God for the Gospel of Mark. The man who showed us our Savior in action as no other one did. Who told us of the many places he went and the great things he did and then ended his gospel by saying that we, his followers, can do the same thing. Amen and amen. The Gospel according to Luke. Note, Luke, the writer of the Gospel of Luke, was also the writer of the book of Acts. So in effect, you might say, Luke is a writer of two books in one, Luke and Acts. Luke was a medical doctor, probably a Greek. He joined Paul's evangelistic and missionary team as a full-time member and was very close to St. Paul. In Colossians 4:14, Paul calls him the beloved physician, not the former beloved physician, not the non-practicing beloved physician. He called him the beloved physician, that is, a man who continued the practice of medicine while at the same time he became a full-time member of the evangelistic and missionary team of the Apostle Paul. We first hear of St. Luke in Acts chapter 20, verse 6, where in his most unassuming way, Luke said, we. And he used that little word, we, several times in that chapter. Luke had the inquiring mind of a doctor. He was profoundly interested in every facet of our Lord Jesus' life. Primarily, before this time, the gospel had been pretty well stationed in the Holy Land by Peter, James, and John, and many others. But Paul, upon his conversion, became a missionary, an evangelist to the world. And in one of his journeys, he met the doctor, and Dr. Luke and he hit it off immediately and became fast and intimate friends in the Lord. Now, Luke, being a doctor, believed in keeping records. He wanted to know the truth about the things which they most certainly believed. And in writing both the Gospel of Luke and the book of Acts, he addresses both of them to a friend by the name of Theophilus, who probably was a nobleman in the Roman Empire, a fellow believer, but who wanted his faith substantiated by the truth, by the facts. You see, at this time, much of the information about Jesus Christ was by word of mouth, and there were many rumors flying around. Luke, taking advantage of the imprisonment of Paul at Caesarea, began a very thorough investigation, clear back to Mary herself. Also to other very personal eyewitnesses of the life of Jesus from the very beginning. It is also noteworthy to point out to you that only Matthew and Luke trace the genealogy of Jesus. Matthew back to David and to Abraham. But Luke goes beyond David, beyond Abraham, all the way back to God himself. He was interested in Christ, the Savior of the world. He uses the word Savior several times. And he mentioned Jesus as the Son of Man on countless occasions, more than any other writer. He was very interested in Jesus Christ, the Son of God, but also Jesus Christ, the Son of Man. And when he refers to Son of Man, he's probably speaking more primarily to the humanity of Jesus, who entered into your and to my humanity, sitting where we sit, feeling what we feel, experiencing everything that we go through, that he might be tested in every way that we are and be touched by the feelings of our infirmities. Yet, through his humanity, depending on the Word of God, his faith in God and the Holy Spirit, he would use only those things which are available to you and me as Christians today to overcome this world and the things in it and to be a triumphant child of God. Luke is a very accurate writer. Luke was very careful to use the Septuagint, which was the translation of the Old Testament in Hebrew into the Greek language by about 70 Hebrew scholars several years before Jesus was born. He was trying to show the meaning of Hebrew names, Hebrew terms to the Gentile world. Chapter 1. Forasmuch as many have taken in hand to set forth an order, a declaration of those things which are most surely believed among us, even as they delivered them unto us, which from the beginning were eyewitnesses and ministers of the word, it seemed good to me also, having had perfect understanding of all things from the very first, to write unto thee in order, most excellent Theophilus, that thou mightest know the certainty of those things wherein thou hast been instructed. There was in the days of Herod, the king of Judea, a certain priest named Zacharias, of the course of Abiah, and his wife was of the daughters of Aaron, and her name was Elizabeth. And they were both righteous before God, walking in all the commandments and ordinances of the Lord blameless. And they had no child, because that Elizabeth was barren, and they both were now well stricken in years. And it came to pass that while he executed the priest's office before God in the order of his course, according to the custom of the priest's office, his lot was to burn incense when he went into the temple of the Lord. And the whole multitude of the people were praying without at the time of incense. And there appeared unto him an angel of the Lord, standing on the right side of the altar of incense. And when Zacharias saw him, he was troubled, and fear fell upon him. But the angel said unto him, Fear not, Zacharias, for thy prayer is heard, and thy wife Elizabeth shall bear thee a son, and thou shalt call his name John, and thou shalt have joy and gladness, and many shall rejoice at his birth, for he shall be great in the sight of the Lord, and shall drink neither wine nor strong drink, and he shall be filled with the Holy Ghost even from his mother's womb. And many of the children of Israel shall he turn to the Lord their God, and he shall go before him in the spirit and power of Elias, to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children, and the disobedient to the wisdom of the just, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. Note, back in the days of King David, he instituted an idea that had proved worthwhile through the years, that the priest situated throughout the land would have the opportunity to come at least once a year to the great temple in Jerusalem and there take an active part. There were 24 divisions of these priests, all going back to Aaron, the first of the high priests. Now, the time has come that Zacharias, from his division, would come to Jerusalem, and his wife, of course, accompanied him. And there, in their righteousness before God, walking in all the ways of the Lord, doing his will, Zacharias was carrying on his work in the temple. Now, Zacharias and Elizabeth were like Abraham and Sarah. They were old, but had no child. There was a great stigma attached to that in those days. So God sent his angel to Zacharias and told him that his prayer had been heard. When the angel spoke to Zacharias that his prayer was heard, Zacharias was frightened. Somehow, when we pray and God begins to answer, we're often surprised. He told him that God was going to visit them, and even though his wife was barren and well stricken in years, that she would have a child, and this child would be great. He really would be the forerunner of Jesus Christ. He would be John the Baptist and would be like Samson of old, a Nazarite who would never drink strong drink, but he would be filled with the Spirit from his mother's womb. Now the purpose of his coming was to turn the disobedient children of Israel back to the Lord. And he would come in the power of the mightiest prophet that Israel had known, Elijah, who had been translated to heaven. And Zacharias was afraid, but he kept listening to the angel. Verse 18, "And Zacharias said unto the angel, Whereby shall I know this? For I'm an old man, and my wife well stricken in years. And the angel answering said unto him, I am Gabriel, that stand in the presence of God, and am sent to speak unto thee, and to show thee these glad tidings. And behold, thou shalt be dumb, and not able to speak, until the day that these things shall be performed, because thou believest not my words, which shall be fulfilled in their season." Note, the penalty for unbelief in his case was that his speech was taken from him. Now the penalty for unbelief takes many forms, but it always comes. Verse 21, "And the people waited for Zacharias and marveled that he tarried so long in the temple." Note, they were always frightened if a priest stayed too long, because that might indicate that he had done something wrong and the wrath of God had consumed him. They were very anxious that Zacharias would come forth to them. Verse 22, "And when he came out, he could not speak unto them. And they perceived that he had seen a vision in the temple, for he beckoned unto them and remained speechless. And it came to pass that as soon as the days of his ministration were accomplished, he departed to his own house. And after those days, his wife Elizabeth conceived and hid herself 5 months, saying, Thus hath the Lord dealt with me in the days wherein he looked on me to take away my reproach among men. And in the 6th month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God into a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin espoused to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David, and the virgin's name was Mary. And the angel came in unto her and said, Hail, thou that art highly favored, the Lord is with thee, blessed art thou among women. Note that the angel told Mary she was highly favored of God. He did not say, Hail Mary, full of grace. That statement is not in the Bible. He said, Hail, thou that art highly favored. The Lord is with thee, blessed art thou among women. Verse 29, And when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying, and cast in her mind what manner of salutation this should be. And the angel said unto her, Fear not, Mary, for thou hast found favor with God. And behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb, and bring forth a son, and shall call his name Jesus. He shall be great, and shall be called the Son of the Highest. And the Lord God shall give unto him the throne of his father David, and he shall reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there shall be no end. Note, Mary, the young virgin, was a part of the remnant. You remember that Malachi, the last of the prophets of the Old Testament, ended his prophecy with a curse. There followed 400 so-called silent years in which there was no major prophet until the birth of Jesus Christ. While Malachi ended with the threat of a curse, the New Testament begins with the promise of a Savior. You see, while Israel was in a disobedient and backslidden state, there was always the faithful remnant, people who kept the law, the word, and the Spirit of God, and Mary was of that number. And friend, you can know that you know that you know that however the world goes afar from God, or if there's even backsliding among the people of God, or even apostasy in the Church of Jesus Christ, there is always a remnant of holy and righteous people who are pleasing to God in every aspect of their life, and it is God who is going to work through them to do His mighty and everlasting works. From the time that David united the kingdom of Israel until the exile of the people of Israel into Babylonian captivity, there had always been the promise of God that he would rule through the house of David, and of his kingdom there would be no end. Now it was at this point that Jesus Christ, the Son of David, took up this promise of God to complete it. And God said of him that there would be no end to his reign. Now, both Joseph and Mary descended from David. Joseph descended from Solomon, and Mary from Nathan, both descendants of David through Bathsheba. It's very important that we know that. Verse 34. Then said Mary unto the angel, "How shall this be, seeing I know not a man?" And the angel answered and said unto her, "The Holy Ghost shall come upon thee, and the power of the Highest shall overshadow thee. Therefore also that holy thing which shall be born of thee shall be called the Son of God." Note, here we see the incarnation, God coming by his Spirit. First of all, God the Son, the everlasting God who created the world. Then the Holy Spirit, who is everlasting God, who conceived the human body of the Son, who coexisted with the Father from the beginning. Now we must see that Mary bore his humanity and not the Christ part. The Christ part was conceived by the Holy Spirit and coexisted with the Father from the beginning. In the mystery of the incarnation, God is becoming flesh, and flesh is becoming God. God is so much man, it's though he were not God, and man is so much God, it was though he were not man. Total God and total man. God, who is eternal, omniscient, omnipresent, omnipotent, man, that he might reflect what God is like. Jesus was later to say in John 14 that if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. Therefore, as we watch Jesus' life and look at his ministry, seeing him preaching, teaching, healing, doing good, we see what God is like, and we fall in love with God rather than have some fear of the mystery of him, of his being so far removed from our sensibilities that we cannot grasp him at all. It is through Jesus Christ that we really come into holy union, full union with the Heavenly Father. Verse 36, and behold, thy cousin Elizabeth, she hath also conceived a son in her old age, and this is the sixth month with her who was called barren. For with God nothing shall be impossible. And Mary said, behold, the handmaid of the Lord, be it unto me according to thy word. And the angel departed from her. Note, while Zacharias was full of doubt and unbelief about the angel's announcement of the birth of John the Baptist through him and his wife when they were both old and his wife was barren, Mary was exactly opposite. She was so sensitive to God and willing and obedient. Although she did not understand in any way, she said, here I am. Let the Lord do unto me as he wills. Behold, I'm a servant girl of the Lord. And at that time, the angel left because he knew he had found the obedient one. You see, obedience is the key to deliverance. It has always been the number one thing with God and his people. When Israel disobeyed, they lost. When they obeyed, they gained everything. And the key to your life and mine with God is obedience. Simply to obey. Whether we understand or misunderstand, whether it's great or small, we simply obey. That's what faith is. Verse 39, and Mary arose in those days and went into the hill country with haste into a city of Judah, and entered into the house of Zacharias and saluted Elizabeth. And it came to pass that when Elizabeth heard the salutation of Mary, the babe leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Ghost. Note, when we read the term, they were filled with the Holy Ghost, that's not the same as being baptized with the Holy Ghost. For later John the Baptist was to say of Christ, he shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost. And that he said after he himself had already been filled with the Holy Ghost. We'll see through Dr. Luke, in the first and second chapters of his second book, Acts, that there is a baptism with the Holy Ghost. Verse 42, and she spake out with a loud voice and said, blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb. And whence is this to me, that the mother of my Lord should come to me? For lo, as soon as the voice of thy salutation sounded in mine ears, the babe leaped in my womb for joy. Note, joy is the surest sign of the presence of God. It is also the surest sign of the strength of God. For we're told by Nehemiah in the Old Testament that the joy of the Lord is thy strength. In some mysterious way, the babe, John the Baptist, leaped in Elizabeth's womb, and it was a leap of joy. The Christian faith was to be announced with joy, and the keynote of it would be the joy of the Lord. Verse 45, and blessed is she that believed, for there shall be a performance of those things which were told her from the Lord. Note, blessed are those who believe, not those who spend their times in endless argumentation and asking millions of questions, but blessed are they who simply believe and obey. The one thing we can stake it all on is that God will be what he is and do what he said he would do. Please note also that Elizabeth was speaking by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, or in a prophetic manner. There was no evidence that Mary was pregnant because her body was not large by that time. She had no communication with Mary. The Holy Spirit revealed to her the pregnancy of Mary, the Great One who was in her, and how that she was blessed of all women in her obedience to do what the Lord said, and the Lord would not let her down. Oh, how precious is the prophetic power of the Holy Spirit. The dreams and visions of the Spirit are just as real today as they were then. Verse 46, and Mary said, my soul doth magnify the Lord, and my spirit hath rejoiced in God my Savior. Note, here very clearly Mary says that God is her Savior. There is no such thing theologically as immaculate conception. That is, that Mary was sinless herself. She was a normal follower of God, a daughter of Abraham, a descendant of David, whose obedience was perfect as far as her ability was concerned, and who believed what God said, and she was looking to him as her Savior. Mary is a marvelous, indescribable, incomparable woman, obedient, faithful, and willing. But beyond that, that's what she is. And in no way are we to pray to her or to think that she sits at God's side and we have to go through her to get to her son. No. Jesus Christ is the mediator between God and man. Verse 48, for he hath regarded the low estate of his handmaiden. For behold, from henceforth all generations shall call me blessed. For he that is mighty hath done to me great things, and holy is his name. And his mercy is on them that fear him from generation to generation. Note, when she finishes glorifying God for doing great things in and through her, she then speaks of his same mercy being upon all who fear him from generation to generation. She's saying that she is a person of low estate who in her obedience to God has been lifted up. And therefore she's saying the same thing to us, that however lowly we may be, when we obey God, God shows his mercy to us and lifts us up in him. Verse 51, he hath showed strength with his arm. He hath scattered the proud in the imagination of their hearts. He hath put down the mighty from their seats and exalted them of low degree. He hath filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he hath sent empty away. He hath hope on his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy, as he spake to our fathers, to Abraham, and to his seed forever. And Mary abode with her about 3 months and returned to her own house. Now Elizabeth's full time came that she should be delivered, and she brought forth a son. And her neighbors and her cousins heard how the Lord had showed great mercy upon her, and they rejoiced with her. And it came to pass that on the eighth day they came to circumcise the child. And they called him Zacharias after the name of his father. And his mother answered and said, not so, but he shall be called John. And they said unto her, there is none of thy kindred that's called by this name. And they made signs to his father how he would have him called. And he asked for a writing table and wrote, saying, his name is John. And they marveled all. And his mouth was opened immediately, and his tongue loosed, and he spake and praised God. and fear came on all that dwelt round about them. And all these sayings were noised abroad throughout all the hill country of Judea, and all they that heard them laid them up in their hearts, saying, What manner of child shall this be? And the hand of the Lord was with him. Note, I want you to notice that when Zacharias had replied to the announcement of the angel, How will I know this? That was unbelief. And the angel had told him he would be dumb. Now when the little baby is born and they want to name him after Zacharias, and his wife said no, they turn to the father Zacharias, who was still dumb. And they knew this was a sign from the Lord. And in order for this sign to be fulfilled and the dumbness to be removed, Zacharias wrote the name John. And largely because of this, all the people were amazed and wondered at what manner of child this would be. Verse 67, And his father Zacharias was filled with the Holy Ghost and prophesied, saying, Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he hath visited and redeemed his people, and hath raised up an horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David. Note, the term horn of salvation usually referred to the horns of oxen, which symbolized power. And he's saying that God had raised up the power of salvation for those of the house of David. Verse 70. As he spake by the mouth of his holy prophets, which have been since the world began, that we should be saved from our enemies and from the hand of all that hate us, to perform the mercy promised to our fathers and to remember his holy covenant, the oath which he sware to our father Abraham, that he would grant unto us, that we being delivered out of the hand of our enemies might serve him without fear in holiness and righteousness before him all the days of our life. Note, Zacharias in his prophetic utterance under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit is speaking of the mighty power of salvation that would come. And through our own faith, we would be delivered from the hand of our enemies and serve God first without fear, secondly in holiness, thirdly, in righteousness. Fourthly, we'll be able to continue to endure all the days of our lives. Verse 76. And thou, child, shalt be called the prophet of the highest, for thou shalt go before the face of the Lord to prepare his ways, to give knowledge of salvation unto his people by the remission of their sins, through the tender mercy of our God, whereby the day spring from on high hath visited us, to give light to them that sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace. And the child grew, and waxed strong in spirit, and was in the deserts till the day of his showing unto Israel. Note, we do know that later, when John the Baptist was grown, that he was a man of the desert. Some have thought that his parents died. We do not know. But we do know that from an early age, he went to the desert in his communion with God in preparation to be the Elijah, or the preparer of the way of the Messiah, and to show the people that there was great light in their darkness. Of course, in Israel, the deserts are never far away. Most of the land is a desert. Chapter 2. And it came to pass in those days that there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed. And this taxing was first made when Cyrenius was governor of Syria. And all went to be taxed, every one into his own city. And Joseph also went up from Galilee out of the city of Nazareth into Judea, unto the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David. To be taxed with Mary, his espoused wife, being great with child. And so it was that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. Note, Mary, the espoused wife of Joseph, was legally his wife, although they had not come together as man and wife. But now Joseph has accompanied her to their own hometown that is to be registered in the city of David their father. It is also very important to notice that while Caesar decided to tax the world and to take a census of the world, that he thought it was his own idea. But God had to move in history and to rearrange things, people, and places in order for his son to be born at the only moment in history that he could have been born. There was no war in the world to take away from the event or to prohibit people from traveling. In addition, the Romans had built great enduring roads, many parts of which remain today in the Mediterranean area. That meant that people could travel, and the news of the child's birth could speed through these hard-surfaced roads to the ends of the Roman Empire. It was a time of peace, it was a time of great roads, and it was a time when there was one universally understood language. And that meant that the birth of Jesus could be told in one language and people could understand without distortion. Now, these are just a few of the things that were propitious that God brought together for the birth of his son, Jesus Christ. And then another outstanding thing. Jesus had to be born in Bethlehem to fulfill prophecy. The problem was how to get them from Nazareth, which was up north around Galilee and was about a 3 days journey at that time. Well, old Augustus Caesar, sitting over there in Rome and making up his mind to tax the world and have a census, didn't know that God was going to use him to get Mary from Nazareth to Bethlehem, use his roads, use the language of commerce which he had chosen to use, and to use the time of his forced peace. Oh, how mighty is God. Verse 7. And she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. Note, that when the angel came to any of those people, they were always afraid. And immediately the angel said, Fear not. There is a satanic fear in the hearts of all of us, particularly when we come into contact with God, with things supernatural and eternal. I don't know why it's there unless it's the consequence of the fall of man in the Garden of Eden. But God does not want us to live with fear. The angels told the shepherds, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. The gloom that's over this world is of the devil. But I thank God that the gospel is a gospel of joy, 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 joy. to all people. Verse 12, and this shall be a sign unto you, ye shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. Note, God has always used signs or particular manifestations through which people will know that it is God. Many of those signs were in the Old Testament. Here is another sign at the birth of Jesus, and there will be many other signs and wonders. The angel also told these shepherds they would find the babe. Don't ever be concerned about finding the Lord. You can find Jesus. So if you have any doubt in your heart, just stop it and understand. Receive the truth. God will let you find his son, Jesus Christ. Verse 13, and suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. Note, these shepherds heard the first song that was sung about our Savior. Glory to God in the highest. In other words, hallelujah. Praise God. Glory to his name, because he has brought peace and goodwill toward men by the birth of his son, Jesus Christ. Verse 15, and it came to pass, as the angels were gone away from them into heaven, the shepherds said one to another, let us now go even unto Bethlehem and see this thing which is come to pass, which the Lord hath made known unto us. And they came with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in a manger. And when they had seen it, they made known abroad the saying which was told them concerning this child. And all they that heard it wondered at those things which were told them by the shepherds. Note, shepherds never leave their flocks by night. It would be too dangerous because the sheep might be destroyed. But these shepherds had heard a greater message. A greater one was awaiting them. Well, they found the babe along with Mary and Joseph. And there at the manger, they looked, they listened, they heard the explanation, they believed it. And they went and told everybody concerning this child. There isn't anybody who can honestly meet Jesus Christ who can hold in the joy or hold back the tide of telling the good news. The dawn breaks, the clouds lift, and the glory comes down, and the joy wells up inside. When you meet Jesus. When I met him at 17, dying with tuberculosis, the joy filled my heart. His presence came up through my limbs, through my body, and I was praising God. My hands were up. I was glorifying the Lord. Now, your conversion may not be in the same methodology as mine, but it's going to be definite. I assure you that. And you're going to have him overflowing your heart. Verse 19, but Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. Note, I want to point out that Mary did not know everything. You remember a moment ago I referred to the fact that it was not an immaculate conception, that Mary was an obscure girl, a humble serving girl. She was a girl who loved the Lord and obeyed him. She didn't understand all. She simply said, may this be unto me as the angel has said. Well, she kept all those things in her heart and she meditated upon them. And she set the stage for all of us to meditate upon the wondrous things of God, things that we don't understand, in ways that God deals with us. Verse 20, and the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen, as it was told unto them. And when 8 days were accomplished for the circumcising of the child, his name was called Jesus, which was so named of the angel before he was conceived in the womb. And when the days of her purification according to the law of Moses were accomplished, they brought him to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. As it is written in the law of the Lord, every male that openeth the womb shall be called holy to the Lord, and to offer a sacrifice according to that which is said in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. Note, this refers to people who were poor, who didn't have a lot of money, but were never excluded from the Lord, even though they would bring only a pair of turtle doves or young pigeons. It was the intent of the heart that counted then and now. Verse 25, and behold, there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. And the same man was just and devout, waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Ghost was upon him. And it was revealed unto him by the Holy Ghost that he should not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. Note, Simeon had a secret. He knew something nobody else in the world knew. He wasn't frightened about dying. The Holy Spirit had revealed to him that he couldn't die until his eyes had looked upon the babe, the Son of God. You know, this is marvelous, how the Holy Spirit can reveal things to you. And when the Spirit reveals them to you, you needn't worry about people causing it to be disarranged or causing it to stop, because the Holy Spirit is omnipotent, all-powerful, and he's going to bring to pass what he has said. Verse 27, and he came by the Spirit into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him after the custom of the law, then took he him up in his arms and blessed God, and said, Lord, now lettest thou thy servant depart in peace according to thy word, for mine eyes have seen thy salvation, which thou hast prepared before the face of all people, a light to lighten the Gentiles and the glory of thy people Israel. Note, this is a reference that goes all the way back to Isaiah's prophecy 42:6, but even beyond that, to Abraham, who was told of God that he'd be a light to the Gentile, to the nations of the world. And here we see where the children of Israel were no longer that light, nor a witness to the nations of the world. But God was not going to leave the nations and the people of the world without light or without a Redeemer. He was going to keep his covenant with Abraham and his love with all his race whom he created in his image. And this man, Simeon, was so in touch with God that he knew this babe would be a light to light the way of all Gentiles and also be the glory of the people Israel. Verse 33, and Joseph and his mother marveled at those things which were spoken of him. And Simeon blessed them, and said unto Mary his mother, behold, this child is set for the fall and rising again of many in Israel, and for a sign which shall be spoken against, yea, a sword shall pierce through thy own soul also, that the thoughts of many hearts may be revealed. Note, now Simeon's reference to a sword piercing the soul of Mary was a reference to the great suffering that she herself would have to endure. And when the people called him all those terrible names and finally killed him, she had to stand by hear all that, see all that, feel all that, to the very depths of her soul. Verse 36, and there was one Anna, a prophetess, the daughter of Phanuel, of the tribe of Aser. She was of a great age, and had lived with an husband 7 years from her virginity. And she was a widow of about 84 years, which departed not from the temple, but served God with fastings and prayers night and day. And she coming in that instant gave thanks likewise unto the Lord, and spake of him to all them that looked for redemption in Jerusalem. Note, now I think it's important to point out that this was not a woman who said, well, I'll just retire and let the church take care of me. But she was one who entered into the service of God. And there the Lord provided for her, giving her proper revelations, and at the right time let her come forth. In fact, at the very instant that Simeon was giving the last of his prophecy, she came in and reinforced it and encouraged all those who looked for redemption. Verse 39, and when they had performed all things according to the law of the Lord, they returned into Galilee to their own city, Nazareth. And the child grew and waxed strong in spirit, filled with wisdom, and the grace of God was upon him. Now his parents went to Jerusalem every year at the feast of the Passover. And when he was 12 years old, they went up to Jerusalem after the custom of the feast. And when they had fulfilled the days as they returned, the child Jesus tarried behind in Jerusalem. And Joseph and his mother knew not of it. But they, supposing him to have been in the company, went a day's journey, and they sought him among their kinsfolk and acquaintance. And when they found him not, they turned back again to Jerusalem, seeking him. And it came to pass that after 3 days they found him in the temple, sitting in the midst of the doctors, both hearing them and asking them questions. And all that heard him were astonished at his understanding and answers. And when they saw him, they were amazed. And his mother said unto him, Son, why hast thou thus dealt with us? Behold, thy father and I have sought thee sorrowing. And he said unto them, how is it that you sought me? Wist you not that I must be about my father's business? And they understood not the saying which he spake unto them. Note, you see, folks today who are seeking God will turn to kinfolks and turn to friends and turn to this one and that one. But you know, to find God, you've got to go back where you left him. And where did you leave him? You left him being God at that moment or time in your life when you really were sensitive toward God, when you're aware that God was real. He's still there. He's still real. They were gone a day, but took 3 days to find him, all because they presumed something. Now, with someone in your life as important as Jesus Christ, you must not presume. You must know. And you can know that you know that you know that Christ is with you. And if he's not, you must not stop until you find him. It took them 3 days. It may take you even more. It may take you less. The important thing is to find him. He was merely telling us there's a point in our lives when spiritual things take precedence over everything. The ethical, moral, spiritual laws of God are paramount, even at the age of 12. A child at that age today can understand. They can understand a lot more than we think. Verse 51, and he went down with them and came to Nazareth and was subject unto them. But his mother kept all these sayings in her heart. And Jesus increased in wisdom and stature, and in favor with God and man. Note, the increase of Jesus' life is a remarkable demonstration for you and me to follow. Not only did he grow in his body, but he grew in wisdom. In addition, he found favor with God and with people. He was busy. He obeyed his parents. He grew. He worked in the carpenter shop. He kept himself busy. As every Jewish child, he learned a trade. He went to the synagogue schools. He went to the house of God on the Sabbath days. He worshiped the Lord. He just became a well-rounded human being. He grew as a whole man, body, mind, and spirit. And to you, as a listener, as a follower of Christ, you should never stop growing. You should never stop learning. You should always be increasing yourself, growing in the Lord, growing in your mind, developing your health, and becoming a more well-rounded human being every day of your life. Chapter 3. Now in the 15th year of the reign of Tiberius Caesar, Pontius Pilate being governor of Judea, and Herod being tetrarch of Galilee, and his brother Philip, tetrarch of Iturea, and of the region of Trachonitis, and Lysanias, the tetrarch of Abilene, Annas and Caiaphas being the high priests, the word of God came unto John, the son of Zacharias, in the wilderness. And he came into all the country about Jordan, preaching the baptism of repentance for the remission of sins, as it is written in the book of the words of Isaiah the prophet, saying, "The voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make his path straight. Every valley shall be filled, and every mountain and hill shall be brought low, and the crooked shall be made straight, and the rough way shall be made smooth, and all flesh shall see the salvation of God." Then said he to the multitude that came forth to be baptized of him, "O generation of vipers, who hath warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Bring forth therefore fruits worthy of repentance, and begin not to say within yourselves, We have Abraham to our father, for I say unto you, that God is able of these stones to raise up children unto Abraham. And now also the axe is laid unto the root of the trees. Every tree therefore which bringeth not forth good fruit is hewn down and cast into the fire." And the people asked him, saying, "What shall we do then?" He answered and saith unto them, "He that hath two coats, let him impart to him that hath none. And he that hath meat, let him do likewise." Then came also publicans to be baptized, and said unto him, "Master, what shall we do?" And he said unto them, "Exact no more than that which is appointed you." And the soldiers likewise demanded of him, saying, "And what shall we do?" And he said unto them, "Do violence to no man, neither accuse any falsely, and be content with your wages." Note, only in Luke are we told about the soldiers. These are Roman soldiers who brutalized the people of Israel, who were always accusing them falsely, and John the Baptist took them on and told them how to behave. But he also did the same thing with the publicans and with the people of Israel. And I think it is important to note that when John pointed out to each of these people specifically what they were to do, that it reminds us that God always comes to us at the point of our need, at the point where we should change. And he deals with us in a specific way. He always individualizes. His love for us, also his concern and compassion, as well as his instructions for our lives. Verse 15, "And as the people were in expectation, and all men mused in their hearts of John whether he were the Christ or not, John answered, saying unto them all, I indeed baptize you with water, but one mightier than I cometh, the latchet of whose shoes I'm not worthy to unloose. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire, whose fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly purge his floor, and will gather the wheat into his garner, with the chaff he will burn with fire unquenchable. And many other things in his exhortation preached he unto the people. But Herod the Tetrarch, being reproved by him for Herodias his brother, Philip's wife, and for all the evils which Herod had done, added yet this above all, that he shut up John in prison. Now when all the people were baptized, it came to pass that Jesus also being baptized and praying, the heaven was opened. And the Holy Ghost descended in a bodily shape like a dove upon him. And a voice came from heaven which said, Thou art my beloved Son, in thee I am well pleased. Note, John the Baptist was bringing the old covenant to an end, to its fulfillment, to that point in time where Jesus Christ, Messiah, would arrive on the scene with his great power to baptize with the Holy Ghost and fire, to endue them with the Spirit of God, so that the Holy Spirit would cleanse and purify their lives and fill them with the very Spirit that created this universe, the Spirit of God, the Spirit that would give them life. John the Baptist knew who he was, the forerunner of the Christ, the Messiah. And let me tell you, his preaching rang through that countryside. He had preached repentance to tell the people to feel their sense of sin, their unworthiness, and their deep need for the Messiah to come. He had told them it was a matter of life and death, that without Christ there would be no deliverance. Therefore they must repent and get themselves ready for the coming of this wonderful Messiah, who is Christ the Lord. And he said that when he comes, he's going to do mightier things than I'm doing. What was John the Baptist doing? He was preaching, teaching, baptizing people in water. But he was not able to lead the people through to the infilling of the Holy Spirit. Oh, I tell you that as we go through Luke, and then John, and into Acts, we're going to see how the power of the Holy Spirit overshadows us and brings us into the new covenant, that covenant of grace, of light, of power, where we become new creatures in Jesus Christ. I thank God that John the Baptist was the one who closed the gap, who brought to an end or fulfillment the old and presented the new, and Jesus arrived as the Son of the living God, ready to fill the people with the Holy Spirit. Verse 23, And Jesus himself began to be about 30 years of age, being, as was supposed, the son of Joseph, which was the son of Heli, which was the son of Matthat, which was the son of Levi, which was the son of Melchi, which was the son of Janna, which was the son of Joseph, which was the son of Mattathias, which was the son of Amos, which was the son of Nahum, which was the son of Eshli, which was the son of Naji, which was the son of Maath, which was the son of Mattathias, which was the son of Simei, which was the son of Joseph, which was the son of Judah, which was the son of Joanna, which was the son of Resa, which was the son of Zerubbabel, which was the son of Salathiel, which was the son of Nera, which was the son of Melchi, which was the son of Adai, which was the son of Kusam, which was the son of Elmodam, which was the son of which was the son of Josi, which was the son of Eleazar, which was the son of Joram, which was the son of Matthat, which was the son of Levi, which was the son of Simeon, which was the son of Judah, which was the son of Joseph, which was the son of Jonan, which was the son of Eliakim, which was the son of Melia, which was the son of Menon, which was the son of Mattatha, which was the son of Nathan, which was the son of David, which was the son of Jesse, which was the son of Obed, which was the son of Boaz, which was the son of Salmon, which was the son of Naasson, which was the son of Amminadab, which was the son of Aram, which was the son of Ezram, which was the son of Pharis, which was the son of Judah, which was the son of Jacob, which was the son of Isaac, which was the son of Abraham, which was the son of Therah, which was the son of Nachor, which was the son of Sarek, which was the son of Rega, which was the son of Phalek, which was the son of Heber, which was the son of Sala, which was the son of Canaan, which was the son of Arpaxad, which was the son of Sem, which was the son of Noah, which was the son of Lamech, which was the son of Methuselah, which was the son of Enoch, which was the son of Jared, which was the son of Malaleel, which was the son of Canaan, which was the son of Enos, which was the son of Seth, which was the son of Adam, which was the son of God. Note, the lineage is traced all the way back to Adam. But over here in verse 31 of Luke 3, we are told that Jesus is traced back to the son of Nathan, which was the son of David. Now that's Mary's genealogy. Joseph came from Solomon, David's son, by Bathsheba, and Mary by Nathan, David's son, by Bathsheba. Chapter 4. And Jesus, being full of the Holy Ghost, returned from Jordan, and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness. Note, it is Luke who reminds us again and again that it was the Holy Spirit who anointed Jesus, that he went in the power of the Holy Spirit, and it was the witness of the Spirit to Jesus' Spirit that gave him the power as a Son of Man to be the full Son of God to deliver the people. And it is noteworthy today that those people who are operating under the charismatic power of the Holy Spirit are reaching in the depths of more people, touching them at the deepest levels of their being. They're the ones whom God is using more than any other to bring healing to the sick, to cast out devils, to bring a new inspiration and anointing of the Holy Spirit. Now let me read verse 1 again. And Jesus, being full of the Holy Ghost, returned from Jordan, and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness, being 40 days tempted of the devil. And in those days he did eat nothing. And when they were ended, he afterward hungered. And the devil said unto him, If thou be the Son of God, command this stone that it be made bread. And Jesus answered him, saying, It is written, that man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word of God. And the devil, taking him up into a high mountain, showed unto him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time. And the devil said unto him, All this power will I give thee, and the glory of them, for that is delivered unto me, and to whomsoever I will, I give it. If thou therefore will worship me, all shall be thine. And Jesus answered and said unto him, Get thee behind me, Satan, for it is written, Thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve. And he brought him to Jerusalem, and set him on a pinnacle of the temple, and said unto him, If thou be the Son of God, cast thyself down from hence. For it is written, He shall give his angel charge over thee to keep thee, and in their hands they shall bear thee up, lest at any time thou dashed thy foot against a stone. And Jesus answering said unto him, It is said, Thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. And when the devil had ended all the temptation, he departed from him for a season. Note, the devil is a personality, just exactly as Jesus is a personality, except he is a fallen archangel, while Jesus is the Son of God. But let us not forget that the devil talks, and people hear the devil. They either hear his voice, or they feel his impressions, or they're persuaded by him, but Jesus talked back. Jesus kept saying, It is written. That was the only thing he said back to the devil, is what God had said. We must not argue with the devil. We must use the word of God and stand on it. Notice also in verse 13 that when these temptations were ended, that did not mean he would not tempt the Lord Jesus again. He simply left him for a season. When we went over the devil once by the word of God and our faith in the Lord Jesus, then the devil may leave us for a particular period of time, but he will return because his battle is a battle between him and God, and we are the ones who are the object. So the devil simply withdraws until he has another opportunity, and he returns to tempt us. Meanwhile, we are studying and knowing the Word of God, immersing ourselves in His teaching, building up our faith in the Lord, and preparing ourselves because we can withstand the devil on every and any issue at any time, any place. Verse 14. And Jesus returned in the power of the Spirit into Galilee, and there went out a fame of him through all the region round about. And he taught in their synagogues, being glorified of all. Note, let me remind you that when the temple was destroyed in the Babylonian captivity, that when they were in Babylon, the Hebrew people established a synagogue type of building in which they would instruct their children as well as the adults. This synagogue was carried back with them when they returned to the Holy Land and rebuilt the temple. These were scattered throughout Jerusalem and the towns and villages of the land. Verse 16, And he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up. And as his custom was, he went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day and stood up for to read. And there was delivered unto him the book of the prophet Isaiah. And when he had opened the book, he found the place where it was written. Note, this was a scroll that as the person read, he unwound it both top and bottom. It was very rare, terribly expensive, because every word was copied by hand, and there was usually only one scroll of any book of the Bible in a synagogue at one time. Verse 18, The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He hath sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. Notice that Jesus said, The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Not even the incarnate Son of God attempted to do God's work without the Holy Spirit being upon him. It is very sad today that many in the Christian church don't even know who the Holy Spirit is. We must come back to the fountain of knowledge, the Word of God, and we must see again our Lord Jesus Christ, that he came in the power of the Spirit, and said that the Holy Spirit was intimately and powerfully upon him. Then he adds, because he's anointed me. He's anointed me. I've often said the anointing is that power of God that comes upon you and then separates you from yourself and fills you with the glory, so that when you speak, it is like God speaking. When you act, it is like God acting. Now, the anointing is so precious to me that when I began this ministry in 1947, I made a vow to God that I would never enter the pulpit to preach without first having experienced the anointing of the Holy Spirit going through me. That is to say, the Holy Spirit's power would come upon me and separate Oral Roberts from himself, and so fill him with the glory of God, that when he spoke, it would be like God speaking, and when he acted, it would be like God acting. That vow has been very precious to me. You see, the Word of God is already anointed, but I must be anointed myself, and so must everyone else who deals with the Word of God. Jesus said that he was sent to preach the gospel to the poor, to the deprived, to the disfranchised. You see again Dr. Luke, who had an eye for the social outcast, for the sick and afflicted, for those who didn't have anything.